For souls an evil hunt, the lengthening of castles, the waving of the stick, such sweet indoctrination, ingested to your choke. Oh, look up at Madonna, there's witchery around. Cloak yourself with garments, a keeper on your crown. Steal a verse from scripture, the Talmud of Sutra. This filthy beast of whorings will overflow your cup, cause you brood of evil vipers. Covenant of love and life eternal. Oh, but you, the root of evil vipers, you won't tell no one, and you won't go in. No, 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 because the serpent instructs the heel of Yahusha. But Yahusha smashed the serpent's head. Selling off your birthright, the pleasures a la carte. You're sucking from the poison that cut away your heart. You are whitewashed tombs of ivory, with your inside full of spite, and making love to demons, yeah, in the synagogue tonight. Will you choose to forgive, or cast them off as weak? A sprinkle of the water, a curl upon your cheek. Bowing down to idols, it's on a global scale. Casting down to ruin Yahuwah's mighty name. You brood of evil vipers, you shut up the doorway to Yahusha. Yes, you do, you brood of evil vipers. You won't tell no one, and you won't go in. No, 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 because the serpent king struck the heel of Yahusha. Yahusha smashed the serpent's head. Ah, Satan knows the fire's coming, and he wants you with him on the judgment day. But you are selling off your birthright for pleasures a la carte. You're sucking from the poisons that cut away your heart. You are whitewashed tombs of ivory, with your inside full of spite, making love to demons, yeah, in the synagogue tonight. In the synagogue tonight. Oh, oh, oh. The brood of evil vipers, a covenant of so much love. Why won't you show the way in? I know, let me tell ya. Your serpent king struck the heel of Yahusha. Yahusha smashed the serpent's head, and Hashem knows the fire's coming, and he wants you with him on the judgment day. birthright, the pleasures a la carte. You're sucking from the poisons that cut away your heart. You are whitewashed tombs of ivory with your inside full of spite. You're making love to demons in the synagogue tonight. In the synagogue tonight.
What is right and what is wrong? What is right and what is wrong?
Most Christians believe that the Judaism of the Old Testament is very similar to Judaism today. Yet the Jewish Encyclopedia, in its article on Judaism, says modern Judaism and the Judaism of the Old Testament are very different. It says that after Nebuchadnezzar conquered Judah in the 6th century B.C. and led the Jews to distant Babylon, the Jews were faced with challenges to their faith they had never before experienced. Most Christians believe that the Judaism of the Old Testament is very similar to Judaism today. Yet the Jewish Encyclopedia, in its article on Judaism, says modern Judaism and the Judaism of the Old Testament are very different. It says that after Nebuchadnezzar conquered Judah in the 6th century B.C. and led the Jews to distant Babylon, the Jews were faced with challenges to their faith they had never before experienced. Ever since the time of Solomon, the religion of Israel had centered around the magnificent temple in Jerusalem with its sacrifices and ritual. The question now became, how could one be a true Jew in a very foreign, even hostile environment? The need arose for a certain class of lay priests, called scribes or sofurim, to interpret the law in this new setting and make it workable. In time, these scribes became what the New Testament calls the scribes and Pharisees, the greatest legal authorities of Israel for all ages. The Pharisees said there were really two inspired revelations to the Jews. There was the written law of Moses, received atop Sinai, but there was also the oral tradition, acquired by 70 elders. When Jesus came on the scene, his reaction was to bitterly denounce this counterfeit tradition. Christ said the Pharisees, by their tradition, had made the law of God of none effect. He considered the Pharisees the most dangerous leadership Israel ever had.
Both you scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites all, for you set up the kingdom of heaven against men. You do not go in yourselves, nor do you let others enter. Blind guide! You strain at a gnat and swallow a camel. You bow before the letter of the law and violate the heart of the law. Justice, mercy, good faith. You are like whited sepulchres, all clean and fair without, but within, full of dead men's bones and all corruption. You see these stones, do you not? I tell you, there will not be left here one stone upon another that will not be thrown down. Yours is a house of desolation, the home of the lizard and the spider. Serpents, brood of vipers, how can any of you escape that? You'll never see me here again. Not until you learn to cry. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. For I and my Father are one and the same.
We'll be right back.
The Talmud confirms Christ's word. In the Talmud, in Treatise Sanhedrin, an extensive passage describes the right of the Pharisee to kill anyone, just as long as he did so indirectly. As one of dozens of examples, the Talmud tells us that if one bound his neighbor and he died of starvation, he is not liable to execution. In such an indirect manner, the Pharisees also killed Christ. Manipulating the Romans to actually wield the spear and sword, the Pharisees claimed, as their descendants do today, that since the Romans were the direct cause of the death of Christ, it is the Romans, not the Jews, who are guilty. Christ also called the Pharisees adulterers, an adulterous generation. The Talmud provides generous loopholes for adultery. It says the penalty for adultery does not include sex with a minor, the wife of a minor, or the wife of a heathen. The Talmud also encourages seduction of unwed adolescent girls called designated bondmaids. But it's important how such rapes are performed. With the designated bondmaid, one is guilty only in the case of natural connection, but not in the case of perverse connection. The Pharisees reasoned that rape in a perverted manner is outside the jurisdiction of the law. Normal rape, however, was punishable. In Babylon, sexual perversion of every kind had been a way of life for millennia. The Pharisees were deeply influenced by such practices. In one of dozens of endorsements of child sex, Simeon ben Yohai said, "A proselyte under the age of 3 years and a day is permitted to marry a priest." Agreeing with Ben Yohai, the great Rava said, "When a grown-up man has intercourse with a little girl, it is nothing. Or when the girl is less than this, 3 years and a day, it is as if one put the finger into the eye." The footnote to this passage says, "As tears come to the eye again and again, so does virginity come back to the little girl under 3 years." The same section confirms that sexual activity with small boys is in the same category. The intercourse of a small boy is not regarded as a sexual act.
Hanukkah, meaning Feast of Dedication, commemorates the great victory of the Jewish people in Israel over King Antiochus Epiphanes, the pagan tyrant who tried to destroy Judaism in 165 BC. It also marks the Jews' rededication of the temple, which was defiled by Hellenists at that time. This holiday is significant for both Jews and Christians alike, since the roots of both religions were preserved through God's deliverance. Indeed, in commemoration of this event, Jesus went to the temple in Jerusalem to celebrate this holiday known then as the Feast of Dedication. Later, it became known as the Feast of Lights to celebrate the religious freedom that was attained and to remember the miracle of the burning oil lamps in the temple. Today, in synagogues across the world, Zechariah 4:6 is still read on this holiday as a reminder that not by might nor by power, but by the Lord's Spirit are His people delivered. Hanukkah, meaning Feast of Dedication, commemorates the great victory of the Jewish people in Israel over King Antiochus Epiphanes, the pagan tyrant who tried to destroy Judaism in 165 BC. It also marks the Jews' rededication of the temple, which was defiled by Hellenists at that time. This holiday is significant for both Jews and Christians alike, since the roots of both religions were preserved through God's deliverance. Indeed, in commemoration of this event, Jesus went to the temple in Jerusalem to celebrate this holiday known then as the Feast of Dedication. Later, it became known as the Feast of Lights to celebrate the religious freedom that was attained and to remember the miracle of the burning oil lamps in the temple. Today, in synagogues across the world, Zechariah 4:6 is still read on this holiday as a reminder that not by might nor by power, but by the Lord's Spirit are His people delivered. King David prepared to build a temple to his God. It would be a holy place where men and women could feel the presence of God. And so David gathered together the finest materials he could find. And when he died, his son Solomon began to build. After 7 years, the house of God was complete. And the joy of the Jewish people was full. For they had looked forward to this since the time of Moses. As time went on, the temple was attacked, destroyed, and robbed of its sacred treasures. But the Jews returned and restored their holy place, for without it they were incomplete. Then came a very strange and subtle foe, Greek culture. It spread not only through Jerusalem, but through the entire world. Even the courtyards of the holy temple saw its effect. Yeah.
I'll see you later. I'm late. You can't leave now. Nasham needs a challenger.
And who better than the hammer?
Hammer! Oh, no.
It will only take a few seconds for me to beat you.
Focus. Ready? Go!
Why they call him the Hammer.
Hello, Mora.
Nathan, is that you under all that Greek cloth?
Now, don't start with me, Mora. Come, I'll walk you to the temple.
Judah Maccabee does that.
Well, today he's obviously forgotten. Come now.
Judah will come for me. And when he arrives, he'll be wearing more than his bedsheets.
Ooh, you're mean and stubborn. Judah's not coming.
If Judah doesn't come in the next 5 seconds, I'll roll around in the dirt.
And I'll do the same if he does come.
Done. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Sorry I'm late. Oh, sorry.
Is that you, Huron?
Mora?
Judah, this is Huron. I used to watch him as a child.
Oh, everyone knows Huron. They say you're faster than all the Greeks put together.
You're no secret either. It's a good thing for me you don't compete.
Come to the temple with us.
No. That's not for me anymore. I'm a Greek now.
That's silly. You can never stop being a Jew.
I can try. Good to see you again, Mora. Judah.
Thank you.
feel so far away from God. But when I come here...
I know, Mora. I know.
Untie the oxen!
What is this?
A gift from King Antiochus.
We have enough of your statues in our courtyards already.
Ah, but this one is different. It's of the king himself.
Is King Antiochus a god now?
He has declared it so. Perhaps you'll find this less amusing. We're putting it up in your temple.
Get out.
They refuse, do they? It's time to force the Jews to do what all other nations have done willingly. From this day forth, I, King Antiochus, decree that every Jew who will not bow down and accept the Greek gods shall die.
Greek or Jew?
Jew! But I have accepted your ways long ago. Surely you see that.
Let your soul to the Greek gods or die.
Never.
I pledge my honor to the Greek gods. I pledge my honor.
Get up, then. You'll now be a Greek soldier.
I'm honored, sir.
I warn you, though. Never betray your new life, or you'll lose it.
No!
There's no use fighting, Judah. They'll kill us all.
Let me die, then.
No! We must get father and our brothers and leave.
The temple, son. The temple.
The temple is worthless if we're all dead. We need your help to stay alive.
Pull, man. Watch your rope. Some slack on the back end.
Bow down.
Jerusalem, look on me and hear. Let this as a reminder that Zeus sees all. Zeus hears all. Zeus knows all. To all Jerusalem, I say, look at your new god, Zeus!
Thank you.
this will have to be your home for now. I'm sorry.
Will we ever see Jerusalem again, Judah? When will we go back to the temple?
Soon, I hope.
Right. It's only a matter of time before the soldiers find us. We'll be killed like all the rest.
Leave, then, if that's what you think.
He's right, you know. The soldiers will come.
I know. Any sign of Mora?
No.
Oh, bless you, Nathan.
I'm sorry this had to happen, Mora. I don't know what to say.
It's all right. Judah will come for me.
I hope you're right.
Go.
We want to look around. Of course you know the penalty for keeping Jews in your house is death.
Well, then you better leave before we both get in trouble.
I am a Greek!
As am I.
I've got my eye on you, Nathan.
A dozen swords, 29 spears. The rest are farm tools and wooden clubs.
We'll be cut to pieces.
We still have this mountain.
That's right. When we see him coming, we'll pick up the mountain and drop it on him.
Close. Come on. Remember, the mountain gives us a position of advantage. You must keep that position. Come at me with everything you've got. Go!
Oh, Huron, thank heavens it's you.
I found one! Over here!
Huron, don't do this.
Huron, in the name of King Antiochus, step outside.
In the name of God, do what's right.
Quick, over here. You're one of us. I am a Greek. I lost them. Two men. They went that way.
Let's get them.
I am a Jew.
It's a Greek soldier, all right.
But just what?
It could be a trap. Get to our positions.
Wait a second.
Judah!
It's you.
We found an encampment of Jews in the mountains led by one Judah Maccabee. Some think he's preparing to lead his little band against us.
Take as many soldiers as you like. Take whatever you need. But kill them all!
There's no way we can survive. It's hopeless.
No, don't lose hope, men. We must fight.
If we run now, at least some of us will live.
Let's go.
Run? Run from what?
Weak and wicked men who worship gods of stone?
We are sons of the living God. A mighty God who divided the sea for Moses. A loving God who saved Daniel from the jaws of a lion.
You think God loved our fathers more than us? Has he lost his power to save?
No. Then rise up, ye men of Israel, and put on the faith of your fathers. For that is all that stands between us this day and the temple of our Lord.
Yeah! Gather all the weapons.
Pull!
In here, this way.
Don't lose your ground. Forward!
It's no good, sir. We should retreat until we can find a better position.
Send every man. Full attack.
We'll never break through.
All soldiers, attack!
Ready, men? On my command. Set. Now!
Gentlemen! A Jew. Always a Jew.
May it always be so.
To Jerusalem! And the temple of our Lord! To Jerusalem!
Thank you.
knew you'd come.
So did I. Never doubted it for a moment.
I sing the praise of Him. His lightless souls depart. To us He has restored the mountain of the Lord, the longing of my heart. To us He has restored.
Early in the morning on the 25th day of the month of Kislev, a celebration for the rededication of the temple began. And although there was only enough pure oil to burn for one day, the menorah stayed lit for 8 days until new oil could be found. To commemorate this miracle, a festival of lights is celebrated every year to remind the people of God's love and mercy in saving Israel and reclaiming the Holy Temple.
A small percentage of the Israeli population, several thousand strong, they are united by religious zealotry and ultranationalism. They oppose Israeli democracy and any peaceful dealings with the Palestinians.
If we want to understand Rabbi Kahana, his message was that we need to go to war because, in fact, what will bring our redemption is not prayer. What will bring redemption is war. But today we're going in exactly the opposite direction. Instead of war, there's peace now. There's an attempt to prevent war at all costs. And if we can force the army to go back to being offensive, an army of revenge, an army which cares about Jews more than anybody else, then we'll be able to bring the final redemption in the only way possible, through war. War now.
They were a warlike tribe that lived deep in the heart of Asia. And they were so warlike that even the Asiatics drove them out of Asia into Eastern Europe. And to reduce this, so you don't get too confused about the history of Eastern Europe, they set up this big Khazar kingdom, 800,000 square miles, only. There was no Russia, there were no other countries, and the Khazar kingdom was the biggest country in all Europe. So big and so powerful that when the other monarchs wanted to go to war, the Khazars would loan them 40,000 soldiers. That's how big and powerful they were. Now, they were phallic worshippers. This is filthy, I don't want to go into the details of that now. It was their religion. The way it was the religion of many other pagans or barbarians elsewhere in the world. Now the king became so disgusted with the degeneracy of his kingdom that he decided to adopt a so-called monotheistic faith, either Christianity, Islam, Muslim faith, or what is known today as Judaism, really Talmudism. So, by spinning a top, he said, eeny, meeny, miny, moe, and he picked out so-called Judaism. And that became the state religion, and he sent down to Talmudic schools of Tel Aviv and Sura, and brought up thousands of these rabbis with their teachings, and he opened up synagogues and schools in his kingdom of 800,000 people, 800,000 square miles, and maybe 10 to 20 million people, and they became what we call Jews. There wasn't one of them that ever had an ancestor that ever put a toe in the Holy Land, not alone in Old Testament history, but back to time, the beginning of time.
And the blessing of Abraham come on every office, through every person that enters into that place. And that the blessing flow beyond any manifestation that any of these people have ever seen. And suddenly they will say, we can no longer turn our backs on the nation of Israel, and we will stand, and we will be firm, and we will win and not lose.
We still see them, we're proud of
them. This is not your land, it belongs to these families.
God gave it to
When the Zionism was, the whole movement of Zionism was created, the concept, the ideology of transforming Judaism from spirituality, a religion, into a materialism, a nationalistic goal to have a piece of land, all the rabbinical authorities said this is antithetical with what Judaism is all about, expressly forbidden in the Torah, because we are in exile by God.
Millions of Christians are holding up the weary arms of Israel's soldiers and giving hope to the tired souls of besieged Israelis. And it wasn't only that Pastor Hagee led them into this camp, but for so many of them, it was Pastor Hagee who taught them that their Bible demands they stand with Israel and that their theology requires that they act on this theological belief.
That Israel has the right to exist because of what happened to the Jews during World War II. Why in Palestine? Don't the Palestinians too have the right to a secure homeland? Why do they have to suffer and make way for the Jews?
Look, we can go back and we can argue over the birth of Israel, the justice of the birth of Israel. We can argue over whether or not there should be an Israel. There is an Israel today. There's a strong Israel today, a vibrant Israel that is not going to disappear. Palestinians have missed opportunities. There is an opportunity today. I don't see any useful purpose in arguing over what justifications Israel has to exist. Israel has all of the justifications in the world to exist. And I don't even think it's appropriate to question the reason why Israel exists. Thank God that there is at least one Israel. An Israel where Jews can live if they want to. They don't have to live there. But if they need refuge, if they want to live in a country that is a Jewish homeland, that's fine. And I think, as I said before, all of us should be delighted that we happen to be around at a time in this world when there is this Israel. To deny Zionism, to reject Zionism, is about as racist an element as you can get. Why should all of these people, Palestinians and others, deserve a homeland if the Jews can't have a homeland? Have not the Jews suffered enough all of the...
I suppose it wasn't missed on anyone, the audience, that Mr. Glitzer was deploying that same familiar lawyer's tactic. The question that was put to him was, if we accept the legitimacy of the state of Israel, why don't we also accept the legitimacy of a Palestinian state? And then Mr. Glitzer went on to tell us all the good reasons why we should accept the legitimacy of the state of Israel. Something which, by the way, I concur with. But that still doesn't answer the question. If one does accept the legitimacy of the state of Israel, why doesn't one also accord the same rights to self-determination and statehood to the Palestinians? That was the question, as I understand it, that was put to him.
Often when there is dissent expressed in the United States against policies of the Israeli government, people here are called anti-Semitic. What is your response to that as an Israeli Jew?
Well, it's a trick. We always use it.
when from Europe somebody is criticizing Israel, then we bring up the Holocaust.
There are certain conditions, according to Jewish law, under which non-Jews may live here. This doesn't apply to the Arabs. They don't fit the category. They have to get the hell out. Whoever leaves under his own steam will save his own life. Whoever doesn't will have to pay the price. This is the land of Israel.
Thank you.
around the world by a monolithic and ruthless conspiracy that relies primarily on covert means for expanding its sphere of influence, on infiltration instead of invasion, on subversion instead of elections, on intimidation instead of free choice. It is a system which has conscripted vast human and material resources into the building of a tightly knit, highly efficient machine that combines military, diplomatic, intelligence, economic, scientific, and political operations. Its preparations are concealed, not published. Its mistakes are buried, not headlined. Its dissenters are silenced, not praised. No expenditure is questioned, no secret is revealed. That is why the Athenian lawmaker Solon decreed it a crime for any citizen to shrink from controversy. I am asking your help in the tremendous task of informing and alerting the American people, confident that with your help, man will be what he was born to be, free and independent.
As his father, 20 years after Hitler had been dead. From that point on, the family name is changed to Hitler. Let's take a closer look and discover the name Zalamov in the family tree. A Jewish name, as the press points out. A Jewish name, as the press points out.
Hitler was coached by Erik Hanninson, a magician and clairvoyant.
Hanninson at that point starts to inveigle himself into the Führer's inner circle, and he starts to teach Hitler some of the tricks of oratory and theatrical presentation, which he'd learned through in his years in the theatre himself. The whole thing was stage managed, you know. It makes our modern spin doctors just look like amateurs.
Ironically, Hanninson, the man who polished the Führer's public persona, was actually an Austrian Jew called Erik Steinmeier. Hitler's voice became a major weapon. Its hypnotic effect worked equally well on the general public and on his close associates. Even his propaganda chief, Joseph Goebbels.
Goebbels writes in his diary in November 1925, I have listened to the boss. He always called him the boss. It was a kind of awakening, in the same way that Hitler was woken by his own voice. I listened to this voice and I knew that the Messiah was in front of me.
Fascist dictatorships depend upon a cult of personality, and Hitler's was masterminded by Goebbels, using very strict censorship laws. This was the ultimate in spin doctrine.
Hitler's voice was a highly created, manufactured voice. The private voice was not allowed to appear. What was important was the public voice, which had a different aura.
For nearly half a century, Hitler's home movies lay forgotten in the archives. There was no way of telling what was filmed when. But if the dates were elusive, the people were not. One of the first to be identified was often seen hovering close to Hitler. His name was Heinrich Hoffmann.
Heinrich Hoffmann was a photographer who became Hitler's personal photographer. He was a photographer about town in Munich, as it were, in the 1920s. And because of his proximity to Hitler, because he was the official photographer, he made a great deal of money out of Hitler's image.
One reason that Hoffmann was so close to Hitler was that in 1932, Hoffmann had introduced the Führer to his then photographic assistant, a pretty young girl named Eva Braun. Home movie cameras were new and expensive, but Hitler was very keen on the new technology, as we can see here. The Führer had long understood the power of mass communication, and in particular film. He recognized its potential to shape the way the Third Reich would be portrayed, from his carefully controlled appearances in the newsreels to his portrayal as a majestic demigod in Leni Riefenstahl's documentaries. Film was essential to the success of the Third Reich. Hitler's enjoyment of film even extended to a private cinema that he had installed in the basement of the Burghof. Heinrich Himmler became the driving force behind the Final Solution and head of the entire Nazi police apparatus. These everyday pictures of a tea party are typical of the sort of events captured on any home movie. But in the context of the horrors of Nazi Germany, these scenes take on a much more sinister tone.
We see Himmler and Heydrich and Karl Wolff, the main players in the SS responsibility for the murder of millions of people.
While Hitler had been overseeing the design and construction of the Burghof and his cozy private world, these men were overseeing the design and construction of the concentration camps. By the time this sequence was filmed, thousands had died in the camps, and in the next few years, millions more would follow them. Hitler, whose political power was based on aggression, hatred, and mass murder, was able to hold people close to him in his thrall, to make them like him. Those who knew him intimately talked about him as persuasive, charming, a magnetic personality. Hitler was incredibly rude about Goering. Now we know one reason. Hitler the vegetarian was dismissive of Goering the hunting carnivore.
Ich schaute zu ihm hinüber, über den Esstisch, und dann wusste ich, es war wahr, was sie sagen. Das Schweine ihr eigenes Fleisch essen.
It is an extraordinary comment for the Führer to make about one of his most powerful lieutenants. There might have been a lack of harmony in the Nazi inner circle, but outside it, there were those who wanted the Führer dead. The time Hitler took power to the time he died at his own hand, there were 17 planned assassination attempts on the Führer.
This is the 10 o'clock news with Deborah Norville.
Coming out revealing secret negotiation between the Nazis and the Zionists in 1933. which allowed German Jews and their assets to go to Palestine.
This is Israel a few days ago, the season of Passover. And this is Germany 51 years ago, the blossoming of Adolf Hitler's springtime. A key factor in the vitality of today's Israel, the book's author argues, was an agreement reached in 1933 between a group of Zionists and the man who would later try to kill every living Jew.
The great irony is that Adolf Hitler became the chief economic sponsor of the State of Israel.
Across the Reich, Hitler's troops shut down Jewish-owned businesses for 24 hours. Within days, American Jews marched calling for the boycott of all German exports. Jews throughout Europe echoed that call, so did Jews everywhere. But a group of Zionists at the same time was quietly negotiating an agreement with the Nazis to allow the emigration of German Jews and the transfer of their assets to Palestine. That deal, reported in August 1933, was the transfer agreement. Palestine, sparsely settled by Jews at the time, was radically changed as a result.
We saw every week transports of German Jews coming to settle in Palestine. And many new professions were introduced by them into the country, and they played a leading role in making Palestine then a more advanced and progressive country.
Live on Channel 5, this is the 10 o'clock news with Deborah Norville.
Coming out revealing secret negotiation between the Nazis and the Zionists in 1933, which allowed German Jews and their assets to go to Palestine. Rich Samuels joins us tonight with the story of the controversy behind the book and the author's struggle to write it. Rich?
Deborah, with the rise of Adolf Hitler to power in the spring of 1933, the Jews of the world were faced with a dilemma. They could raise a cry of protest, a cry few would heed, or they could make a deal with Hitler, a deal that would bring a step closer their dream of an independent Jewish state. The choice they made was difficult and agonizing. This new book describes that choice. The book is called The Transfer Agreement.
This is Israel a few days ago, the season of Passover. And this is Germany 51 years ago, the blossoming of Adolf Hitler's springtime. A key factor in the vitality of today's Israel, the book's author argues, was an agreement reached in 1933 between a group of Zionists and the man who would later try to kill every living Jew.
The great irony is that Adolf Hitler became the chief economic sponsor of the State of Israel.
It will be an argument against, and a wrong argument against, Zionists.
Some who lived through those times fear the response to this book. The parents of the author feared its very writing.
When your son came to you and said he was going to write this book, what were your feelings about his undertaking?
I told him he's not my son anymore.
Why did you say that?
I told him I'm going to sit shitty.
As though he were dead?
That's right.
I tell him I don't like it. Because as being a Jew, I didn't want something to uncover on my own people.
I was buried in a grave with only seven people. I was seven times captured.
Edwin Black's parents are Holocaust survivors.
For what?
My parents never talked much about the Holocaust.
Edwin Black, to fill the void left by the silence of his parents, has written this book, a dense, detailed chronicle of the early months of 1933. January 30th, 1933. Hitler becomes Germany's interim chancellor. The Third Reich has begun. But in this country, on March 4th, attention is diverted by the inauguration of Franklin Delano Roosevelt.
More power to you, President Roosevelt. The entire country's behind you, thrilled with hope and patriotism.
But ominous headlines tell what's already happening to the Jews of Germany.
The protest of American Jews was heard almost immediately. It was based on only the sparsest of press reports, and nowhere was that protest more vocal than here in New York City.
All crazy
aides, local and national organizations, and labor parties are joining in this gigantic demonstration passing through famous Washington Arch. Rabbi Stephen S. Wise, honorary president of the American Jewish Congress, leads the procession down Fifth Avenue on foot.
Father arranged for the first great mass meeting at Madison Square Garden to protest terrorism. He felt that when freedom was threatened, silence condoned oppression always.
Thousands who waited hours behind police lines rush forward as the doors of Madison Square Garden are open. Jews and Gentiles join in the race for seats, and 22,000 of them get in.
I was a young kid then, you see, as a teenager. And I belonged to a Zionist youth group. And we were all summoned to go to that rally. Well, it was a very agitated crowd. Many Yiddish speaking, a few English speaking. Rabbi Wise mounted an appeal to the Jewish people to do something to save Jewish honor.
Most of the important, well-established Jews were very angry at him, said this was sensationalism, and that if anything happened to the Jews in Germany, the blood of the Jews would be on his head.
Dr. Stephen S. Wise, rabbi of the Free Synagogue and a national leader of liberal thought, speaks in behalf of the Jews of the United States.
This is not a Jewish meeting. This is the conscience of America making itself felt.
The conscience of Nazi Germany made itself felt 5 days later. Across the Reich, Hitler's troops shut down Jewish-owned businesses for 24 hours. Within days, American Jews marched calling for the boycott of all German exports. Jews throughout Europe echoed that call. So did Jews everywhere. But a group of Zionists at the same time was quietly negotiating an agreement with the Nazis to allow the immigration of German Jews and the transfer of their assets to Palestine. That deal, reported in August 1933, was the transfer agreement. Palestine, sparsely settled by Jews at the time, was radically changed as a result.
I lived in Palestine from 1933 to 1936. And we saw every week transports of German Jews coming to settle in Palestine. And many new professions were introduced by them into the country. And they played a leading role in making Palestine then a more advanced and progressive country.
Israel is really what it is because of the foundation laid by the Eastern European group and then the lift toward an educated and well-organized government that came with the immigration of the German Jewish group.
German Jewish settlement of Palestine was, for a time, official Nazi policy. These photos of Jewish life in Palestine, along with a lengthy text, appeared in 1934 in the Berlin paper Der Angriff. The publisher, Hitler's propaganda minister, Josef Goebbels. A Nazi Visits Palestine was the title of the multi-part series. A medal was struck by Goebbels in commemoration. On one side, the swastika. On the other, the Star of David. Hitler demanded one concession for the transfer agreement, that the call for a boycott of the Reich raised by Jews here and elsewhere be rejected by the Zionists. The Zionists made that concession. And so, while Nazis were marching in Germany, and while Jews were marching here, diplomacy was running a more important story. In the Mediterranean, where the dream of a nation-state for Jewish people came a step closer to reality. The story in this book some will find hard to accept.
I still feel the hurt. But after I read it, I said, I'm all with you. Go ahead and write it.
Because everything was exactly what happened, and that's the truth, and you cannot deny it. And the truth must prevail.
And I'm not worried by the people who will find the book in bad taste. The smart people, the intelligent people, the people who went through will understand.
The author is torn
is torn between two profound feelings, that he has to be for a Jewish state, and that the silence which his parents have kept, well, he has to retaliate against that silence, and he takes it out on others.
It was a quest. It took me around the world. Financially, it depleted me. Emotionally, it drained me. And as far as my being a Jewish person and understanding my Jewish identity and my relationship to Israel and the Holocaust, it has fulfilled me. It has given me identity.
That he tries to exorcise his own demons by creating ghosts to visit the nights of others is really a very personal drama. And my only hope is that he will not damage the people, the state, and the brethren and sisters who we proclaimed to cherish.
Did you find what you wanted to know?
Yes, I know what happened, and I know why.
The transfer agreement will be available shortly. Macmillan is the publisher. Deborah?
Thanks, Rich. Really interesting.
Well, would all the violence and conflict in the Middle East evaporate if Israel simply ceased to exist? My next guest says Israel is not only breaking Jewish law with its military strikes against the terrorist group Hezbollah, but that the state of Israel itself should not even exist in the first place. What you may find more shocking is that the person saying that is a rabbi. He is Yisrael Weiss from Jews United Against Zionism. Rabbi.
Yes.
Pretty strong words.
Yes, but this is the view that was shared by all religious leaders throughout, the last 100 years when the Zionism was, the whole movement of Zionism was created. The concept, the ideology of transforming Judaism from spirituality, a religion, into a materialism, a nationalistic goal to have a piece of land. All the rabbinical authorities said this is antithetical with what Judaism is all about, expressly forbidden in the Torah, because we are in exile by God.
So you shouldn't have a state. Shouldn't have a country. You shouldn't have a government.
We shouldn't have a state. We should be living amongst all the nations as the Jews were doing for 2,000 years, as loyal citizens, people who are serving God, emulating God with compassion. And the Talmud states clearly that if we will attempt to breach these oaths of God, of trying to leave God, it will just bring to this death and catastrophic results for the Jews. We find that since the inception of Zionism, the state of Israel, there's an endless river of suffering for the Jews and non-Jews alike. And contrary to what people believe, that there is a religious conflict, we have been living for hundreds of years amongst the Muslims and Arab communities without any UN human rights groups to watch.
So life, let me ask you this, Rabbi. Was life better for the Jews prior to the creation of the Jewish state of Israel?
100%. In Palestine, we have the testimony of the Jewish community living there and other lands that they were living in harmony, and they pleaded with the United Nations. In the documents we have, the chief rabbi of Jerusalem said, we do not want a Jewish state. The Muslims, Christians, and the Jewish inhabitants were ignored with the creation of the state.
Nevertheless, you might not have had a country per se, but you were not a stranger to being abused or slaughtered. Over the millenniums, right? And particularly as recently as 50, right. 60 years ago.
There is an issue of being killed because of anti-Semitism, and then there's another issue where you antagonize and you create your anti-Semitism through Zionism. Doing that, in other words, it's not a free-for-all. You'll knock out your neighbor's windows and then yell anti-Semitism.
All right, now I know you are an Orthodox Jew. What do traditional Jews think of that position?
Well, this was the mainstream view of worlds, Jewish people worldwide, whether it was...
Well, I know it was. Yes. It isn't now. So what do they tell you now?
Well, let's just talk about the religious point of view, because we're talking about the Judaism, not people who have left the folds of Judaism.
Right.
The Jewish view is that the mainstream view would be that, true, we shouldn't be having a state, but once it's created, the Zionist propaganda that the Arabs want to throw every Jew into the ocean, and there's an ingrained hate against the Jews, which they've convinced many Jews to believe. This is why they are fearful of returning the land.
Well, you can't blame them, right? I mean, you have the president of Iran who says the Holocaust never existed, and if he had his druthers, he'd destroy Israel and all the Jews.
That's also patently false. He has a Jewish community in Iran, and they haven't murdered them when they had the opportunity.
So you don't take him at his word that he would try to kill Jews?
He would want to the dismantling of the political state of Israel. We went a whole group of rabbis this last year to visit Iran, and we were taken up by the leaders. We met with the vice president. He was in Venezuela at the time. We met with the religious leaders. All of them stated that unequivocally that they don't have a conflict with the religion.
So as long as Israel exists, Rabbi, you think just itching for trouble. Right?
Jews are suffering, the Palestinians, the Lebanese are suffering. We pray for the speedy and peaceful dismantlement of the state.
It's interesting, Rabbi, you don't hear that view often. Thank you for stopping by.
Thank you very much.
I'm going to go to the hospital.
A quien dice que es más rico, que es a Hadion Club, Shod, Hamo Shod, Bagheva, Dangle, Bo. A Vodeshot, Hamo Shod, Shod, a Paya, Yasli, Stadin, Gam Hadion, Observatorio. Я сын повитуглый вор. А когда еще эти хасиды матпилищи ковли на мыльдине тетинха, да, что это вот, а то халаба.
Love him, run by the tree that we adorn. We decorate our eggs with the new people and fling them. they are gathered. Hear my name, I'll be with them. Although you are scattered, I'm drawing you back to love you again. So come unto me, my child, and I'll give you peace. Then you will be the nation I love. On Yeshua will feast. B'nai Shalom, children of peace. B'nai Shalom, through Yeshua will be. B'nai Shalom, love one another. Sister, my brother, do as I command you, and come unto me, my child, and I'll give you peace. Then you will be B'nai Shalom. Yeshua will.